Hi everyone and welcome to this video about the HP ProDesk 490 G2 Micro Tower or MT. I got this PC for a nice price on an auction and was happy to see that my model has the highest CPU and even some additional upgrades installed. I love watching Teardown and Assembly videos myself, so I figured that I want to participate as well by doing this video. Let's get to business and start with looking at the outside. On the front, there isn't much to see. On top we have the CD or DVD writer, which is a slim model. Not sure why, as there is plenty of space for a full 5.25-inch model. Beneath that we have the power button and power light, two USB 3 ports, microphone in, audio out, and an SD card reader. On the back we can see that the motherboard is mounted upside down, which is a bit unusual. And we see the power connector, connections of a separate video card, audio, DVI, VGA, 4 times USB 2, another 2 USB 3 ports and RJ45 for the network. Finally, on the bottom, we see a serial port and PS2 for mouse and keyboard. Now let's have a look inside. As mentioned, the motherboard is mounted upside down, so the panel that you can open is on the left side of the tower, which is not so common. Once inside, we can see an aftermarket installed 256GB Samsung SSD and the original 1TB hard disk. The video card here is not aftermarket, as the 490 G2 came with different video card options. You had models with onboard Intel HD from the chipset or separate cards from both AMD or Nvidia. My model has an Nvidia GT630DP with 2GB of VRAM. We can also see that there are two memory DIMMs installed, which was an aftermarket upgrade as well, for a total of 16GB of RAM. Let's start the teardown and see how that goes. I'll start by removing the video card. This is that Nvidia GT630. As you can see, it has two DisplayPort connections and one DVI connector. Let's first disconnect the SSD hard drive and DVD drive so you can remove them easily. To remove the slim drive, there is a small latch on the side of it. We can simply hold it and slide the drive out. Now we can unscrew and remove the SSD, which is mounted in a 3.5-inch bracket. Last of the drives is the hard disk, which seems to be a model from Toshiba. Let's remove the rest of the cables that is connected to the motherboard, and I'll start with the SATA cables. Then we can disconnect the power connectors. And finally, the remaining smaller connections for the front panel, front USB, SD card reader, front audio, and the internal speaker. Only thing left is the case fan. Now that everything is disconnected, we can easily remove the motherboard by unscrewing it. Now that we have the motherboard out, let's have a closer look at it. Here is the CPU cooler, which obviously has the CPU under there. The 490 G2 came with a lot of different CPU models from Intel's 4th generation Haswell line. i7, i5, i3, Pentium and even Celeron processors. My model seems to have an i7-4790 CPU installed, which was the fastest model available at the time. Here you can see the memory. The CPU and board supports DDR3 memory for a maximum of 32 GB. I have 2x8 GB installed right now. Memory is dual channel, so you have channel A, channel A, channel B, channel B. For optimal speed, if you only have two DIMMs, they should be in the same color slots. Then we can see the power connector, SATA connectors, connector for a parallel port, and front USB connectors. In terms of expansion slots, the bottom PCI slot is downshifted to X4. We have 2x X1 and the X16 slot. This small white slot over here is for a DisplayPort extension. Never heard of that, to be honest. Over here we also have a header for an additional serial port in case that would be needed. The BIOS chip is over here, and in case you would need to flash it, you can also find a video on that on my channel. Let's continue and take the memory out. As mentioned, 2x8 GB was installed. Now let's remove the CPU cooler by removing the four screws that hold it to the board. This exposes the CPU, which is covered in thermal paste and dust. Let me take some alcohol and I will remove that old thermal paste to make everything clean. Now we can clearly see the CPU socket and model i74790 that is installed here. To remove the CPU, we need to lift the lever on the right side of the socket and then we can get it out. This completes our disassembly part, and here we have all the components lined out nicely. The DVD drive, CPU cooler, CPU, memory, video card, SSD, hard drive, and finally the motherboard. Time to continue and start with the reassembly process. First one to be installed is the CPU, which we can simply insert as long as it's in the right position. Then we can close the socket. Of course, we need to apply fresh thermal paste. And then we can reinstall the cooler. Next up is the memory. As mentioned, we need to use 2x the same color for optimal dual channel performance. We also shouldn't forget to connect the CPU cooler. Been there, done that. Now we are ready to put the board back in the case, but unfortunately I forgot to press the record button for that. Once installed, we need to reconnect everything for the front panel, front audio, the built-in speaker, SD card reader, and USB ports. Now the power connections. Starting with the P4 cable, and ATX power connector. The hard disk needs to be mounted upside down, slides in, and is fixed with four screws. Before we install the SSD, I'll connect the SATA cables while I can still reach them. Then we can install the SSD, again with 4 screws. Once fixed, we can connect the SATA cable to it and make sure the drives have power. The slim DVD drive just goes in at the front and then needs to be connected to power and data as well. Last one to be installed is the video card and the cover for the expansion slots. That's it. Reassembly should be done and we can close the case. In the meanwhile, I've connected the machine to power and the display, and let's see if I did a good job reassembling everything. Power on seems fine, so let's go into the BIOS by pressing F10. CPU and memory are detected just fine. And so are the drives. Few seconds later, we can see Windows boots up without issues as well. Let's do some quick benchmarking now. One of my favorites is Geekbench, as it's available on Windows, OS X, and Linux. As you can see, the system, although a few years old, performs still pretty good. That was it for this teardown and reassembly. I really hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, please put a thumbs up. If you like this or similar content, don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I hope to see you back here soon.